Hello, and welcome on Non-Standard Models. My name is Gaëtan, and today we'll dive in the world, the beautiful world hidden at the intersection of mathematics and physics. You all know what a matrix is. It's a table, or else it will be square, filled with numbers. If you choose your numbers at random, it's what we call a random matrix. This seemingly simple-looking object attracted the attention of physicists and mathematicians who discovered it appeared in algebraic geometry, in statistical physics, and even in quantum gravity. Let's find out why. Let's flash back to the first half of the 20th century, when physicists tried to understand the property of atomic nuclei. A nucleus is made of protons and neutrons, which interact. And when you send a beam of other particles on the nucleus, sometimes it reacts, sometimes it doesn't. It's a resonance phenomenon. So atomic nuclei have energy levels. And when you send something with an amount of energy which is exactly enough to jump from one energy level to another, it reacts strongly. To predict the energy levels, we use quantum mechanics. In quantum mechanics, the time evolution of a system is described by a large matrix called the Hamiltonian, which depends on the interactions. Given a matrix, one can associate a collection of numbers called eigenvalues, and the energy levels are exactly the eigenvalues of the Hamiltonian. For light nuclei like hydrogen or helium, we can compute exactly or with good approximation the energy levels. But for heavy nuclei like mercury or uranium, this matrix is extremely complicated and it is totally hopeless to find the energy levels. In the 50s, the theoretical physicist Eugene Wigner proposed the idea that since the Hamiltonian for heavy atomic nuclei is so complicated, maybe it looks the same as a large random matrix. So he computed the distribution of the distance between energy levels for a large random matrix, and he found very good agreement with what had been measured experimentally for heavy nuclei. This sparked a broader interest of physicists since then into random matrix theory. Fast forward to the end of the 70s. By then, physicists had developed quantum field theory, or short QFT, as an efficient way to describe the fundamental interactions of nature, like electromagnetism or the weak interaction responsible for radioactivity. And they realized that random matrix theory is a very simple type of QFT. Instead of having fluctuating fields expanding over all space-time and whose excitations are responsible for particles, space-time is replaced by a point, and the fluctuating field is replaced by a random matrix. It's a much simpler example of QFT because it contains only a finite amount of information. In QFT, as a principle, we can only predict the probability that certain events are realized. And this probability is expressed as a weighted sum over all possible ways for that event to be realized, and that can be infinitely, very infinitely many. So computing this weighted average can be a very daunting task. And physicists have invented a trick to do that. It's called FMan Diagrams. Roughly speaking, you group terms together. Each term corresponds to a diagram and has a certain value. You just need to sum these values. Since random matrix theory is a particular example of QFT, there's a similar story here as well. In that case, FMan diagrams turn out to be surfaces made out of polygons. So to compute observables in random matrix theory, you need to sum, it's like summing over surfaces. You need to sum over all possible ways to glue polygons together to form a surface, and each of these terms come with a certain number, and you sum all of them. Why physicists are so much in love with random matrix theory? Well, the answer has to do with gravity. We all know gravity. That's the force that keeps us from floating in space. Since Einstein, we understand gravity as a manifestation of the fine geometric structure of space-time. But at microscopic level, it's still pretty mysterious. We don't, in fact, know even now what it is. But we expect it's described by quantum theory. This means we should be able to see the net effect of fluctuating geometries of space-time. In random matrix theory, that's exactly what happens. the way polygons are glued together to form a surface that does affect the fine geometric structure of the surface. So we can see random matrix theory as a kind of a two-dimensional gravity theory. It's not quite the theory of gravity that should govern the world in our daily life, but it's still quite interesting mathematically and physically. We have seen that computing observables in random matrix theory and counting surfaces with certain types of waves are two facets of the same problem. In fact, there are many different surface counting theories which differ by the choice of weighting for each of the surfaces in this counting problem. The area of mathematics which deals with such counting problem is called enumerative geometry, and this is a field where physicists and mathematicians have a lot to learn from each other. For instance, Maria Mirzakhani was awarded the Fields Medal in 2014, and one of her important contributions has been to compute a number of certain kind of surfaces called hyperbolic. On the other side, the development of string theory since the 80s in physics, and in particular among others the work of Witten, has given mathematicians innovative ideas to study geometry, which they would never have had on their own. This fruitful interaction is going on since 40 years. Studying physical theories like UFTs or geometry give rise to algebraic structures that help us organize our computations and thoughts, but also reveal common threads between the theories. We would miss these connections if we limited ourselves to investigate the models that are directly relevant to the description of nature. An example of these structures is called topological recursion. It's a way to approach the counting surface problem by chopping the surface into smaller pieces. It's one of the many versatile mathematical structures that have been identified in different problems of mathematics and physics in the past 30 years. And going to the root of these miracles, understanding and discovering and explaining these surprising connections is one of the several motivations to study mathematical physics. Maybe we'll talk about that another time on Standard Models.